Ooh, good morning, everyone. I think it's the first time I've come up here and everybody's already quiet. It's so lovely. It must be the ice cold weather that we've had this week. Everybody's just concentrating on trying to stay warm. I've got a few announcements this morning. So we continue with our morning prayer groups, which is from 9:30 to 10 in the mother's room at the back there. There are some lovely handmade Christmas cards that were made by Dell's Sabbath School class. And she's asking if, I think she's got about 13 Christmas cards, if I'm 11 Christmas cards, she would like to hand out to some of the adults at the end of the service. So please do meet her out in the foyer area if you'd like to receive some gorgeously made, handmade Christmas cards by the children in her Sabbath School class. Again, also straight after the service this afternoon, there will be a choir practice here at the front. So please do make your way to the front for a choir practice. This evening is going to be the teens and youth Christmas party. So that takes place from 7:30 to 10. The Christmas cafe, I believe that is behind. The Christmas cafe will be starting tomorrow. That's Sunday, the 18th of December, starting at 12. There's several different, it's a kind of a routine that's taking place there. So do please check the poster to see the information about the cafe that starts tomorrow. If it's not too short notice, just do get in touch with Michelle if you'd like to assist with her. For several weeks now, we've had a gorgeous display of flowers behind us, and these were donated by Darlene. I don't see her here, but she's had a card that she's wanted to have read out to you. So the enclosed is four flowers for the church. My husband had a recent health scare, and after MRIs and biopsies, got the all clear. And she is so grateful to God, not just for this, but for putting everything we receive in our daily lives. So, her flowers are in thanks to God for helping and guiding and protecting her and her husband. And then I'm just going to call Helen Jo up to the front for an announcement, and then followed by Pastor Nathan, who would also like to make an announcement. Thank you.
Just a little bit of good morning, everybody, by the way. Just a little bit of feedback. We had our Christmas party last week for the children, and it was fantastic. All right, we had so much fun, but we just want to use this opportunity to thank the church for their prayers and for their love. And there's three special people who we want to thank. Oh, they're here. That's lovely. So could Auntie Michaela, Uncle Mac, and Uncle Nigel come up, please? Thank you very much. Michaela's looking at me like, hmm? The kids just want to say thank you for what you did to make their party so enjoyable. Okay? So thank you very much. Uncle Nigel? Come here. Thank you very much. Please keep praying for our children. We had 55 children on our list, and there were about just under 50 that attended. We have a lot of children in our church. We've got to protect them. We've got to show our love to them and pray for them, most importantly. So thank you very much for letting them feel part of the church family. Amen.
Well, Helen Joan knows what I'm of what I'm about to say, but she didn't know to make that a nice segue into what I was going to say. But 3 weeks' time is a church potluck. It's the first Sabbath of January. And I want to use the opportunity directly after the potluck for parents, for anyone that is, you've got your parenting young people from naught to 20 or more if you want, but us just to come together to look at what we're doing through the ages. There will be department people there, we've spoken, haven't we? There will be department people there to talk through how we can look at our continuity. We've got lots of younger kids, we've got lots of teens and older ones as well. If all of them came every week, I don't know where we'd fit everyone, but it's a great problem to have. Not that it's a problem as such, but a situation to have. So 3 weeks' time, there will be a letter coming out to everyone explaining all of this, but just to let you know, 3 weeks' time, I would love to have your attendance and your participation. Thank you.
Well, good morning, St. Albans Church. It's wonderful to have you here this morning and just my chance to be able to, you know, welcome you here. If we are people visiting with us this morning, just thank you for being here with us today. And if you're joining us online and you're watching this now or watching this afterwards, we hope that it warms your hearts to be with us this morning. Now, I've got to admit that some people might be challenging to be here this morning in the middle of rail strikes, in the middle of ice on streets. I know for me personally, I do love the snow. I grew up somewhere where there was no snow whatsoever, so this is still a novelty for me. However, once it turns into ice, the novelty is gone, and I cannot stay upright on ice. So for anybody that's had that as a challenging week this week, I'm just so glad you've managed to make it here. For anybody that's been learning to drive this week, I'm sure it's been even more challenging for you, and probably more challenging for the parents if they've been sitting beside them. But I really hope that you've managed to get through that this week. It looks like this is the closest I'm going to get to a white Christmas. I think it's been 15 years, and I've never managed to have one so far, but I'm glad that I'm getting ever so closer the longer I have been in the UK. But as we are in church today, I hope that as you feel the warmth as we manage to sit here together, you don't just feel it together, but you feel the warmth in your heart as we start to come and worship our God together. So as you just open our service, why don't you just close your eyes and pray with me just for a minute as we invite our God to be with us. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you so much for being with here. And I pray, dear Lord, as we start our service today, that your Holy Spirit be with us. Open our hearts, dear Father. And we thank you so much that you warm us. In your precious name, Father. Amen. So welcome to St. Albans Church this morning, everyone.
Pleasant Sabbath, everyone. Pleasant Sabbath, everyone. I think I need to get you guys warmed up, right? So you're going to repeat after me. It's a great day because I am loved by Jesus. I know it. I feel it. I live it. We have the blessed assurance. Again, we have the blessed assurance that we are loved. Let's all stand as we start our song service this morning. Salvation, virtue.
Spirit washed in His blood.
This is my story.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Perfect submission.
Perfect submission.
Church say? Amen. You may be seated. Now, if you're not singing on the next song, I'm going to make you stand again, okay? Just to be clear.
Morning, church. Happy Sabbath. So the scripture reading today is taken from 1 John 4, 7, verse 10. So 1 John 4, 7, verse 10. And it reads, "Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. Anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God. But anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. God showed how much He loves us by sending His one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through Him. This is real love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins." Amen.
Amen. Everyone say, welcome, Charles. We're going to continue our praise and worship. Let's get the next song on the slide, yeah. And we're going to sing Power of Your Love.
Lord, I come to You, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I've found in You. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by
voices, hold me close.
Hold me close. Let your love surround me. Bring me near. Draw me to your side.
Sing the second verse, Lord, unveil. Close. Hold me close, just the congregation. The deacons to come and take the offering at this time, and we're going to continue to sing. If you know this song, please, it's called We Are So Blessed. It's a very old song, so if you know it, do join us.
We are so blessed by the gifts from your hands. I just can't understand.
so much. We are so blessed. We just can't find a way or the words that can't say. Thank you, Lord, for your touch. 'Cause when you're empty, you fill us till we are overflow. When you're hungry, you feed us and cause us to know. We are so blessed. Take what we have to bring. Take it all, everything. Lord, we love you so much. We are so blessed by the things you have done, the victories we've won, and what you've brought us through. We are so blessed. Take what we have to bring. Take it all, everything. Lord, we love you so much. 'Cause when we're empty, you fill us till we overflow. When we're hungry, you feed us and cause us to know. We are so blessed by the gifts from your hand that just can't understand why you loved us so much. We are so blessed. We just can't find a way or the words that can say. Thank you, Lord, for your touch. We just wanted to say thank you, Lord. We love you so much. Amen.
So, do the young ones want to come to the front for our story time? Well, good morning. Have you had a good week? Yes, are you sure? Anyone still recovering from your wonderful party last Saturday evening? That was amazing, wasn't it? So it's so nice to see you, and there's a lot of younger ones here, and it's great to see you guys. Anything special happened for you this week? Anyone had anything special happen? No? No one's had a birthday, anything else like that? No? No? Okay. Well, what happened for you? No? Okay. So I have a little story for you, and I need to tell you some information first. You see, this is about something that that happens up in the sky. We don't normally get to see it at this part of this country, but there is a phone app that you can get to see if there's any chance of seeing anything. Kind of talking in riddles now, but maybe northern parts of Scotland you'll be able to see this particular thing that happens in the sky. Anyone guessing maybe what I could be talking about? It is Aurora Borealis. Oh, does that help anything? No. There's another name for it that we call, at least at this side of the planet, the Northern Lights. Anyone heard of the Northern Lights? So I'm going to quickly try and show you a picture and keep on this page. It's not a very big screen there on this one, because I need to see. Can you see those lights up in the sky? that happens for real. And what happens is little particles, electrical charged particles, enter the atmosphere. And because they're electrically charged, they kind of get attracted to the North Pole and the South Pole. But we're nearer the North Pole here, so we more hear of the Northern Lights. And when the conditions are right, then these particles interact with the electricity and stuff like that. And anyway, you can see at night time, you can see it happen, because it happens during the day as well anyway. But it makes the gases in the atmosphere interact with them, and they make colours in the sky. Isn't that amazing? Did you see what colours were in that picture? What colours can you see up in the sky? What can you see? A green. Red and green. In fact, that is why I've got it on this page here. It says the two primary gases in the Earth's atmosphere are nitrogen and oxygen, and these elements give off different colours during the aurora display. The green is when we see in the aurora is characteristic of when it touches oxygen. While hints of purple, blue, and pink are caused by nitrogen. So lots of technical story details there. But it is amazing. And people pay a lot of money to go to places, maybe even to go on a boat, to go and see these things that happen in the sky. But the conditions have to be just right. So you can't guarantee that it will ever happen while you're visiting the place. Would you like to go somewhere and see this kind of colours in the sky at night? I know I would. And one day, I had a chance to be on a canoe trip for a whole week. Do you know what a canoe is? What's a canoe? What's a canoe? A boat. Yeah. Yeah, and I would sit in the boat a little bit like I'm sitting now. And it's an open-top little long boat, and I would have a paddle, and I would paddle along, and I would have a couple of other people with me in the boat, and there were a few of us that were in canoes. But before we went out canoeing, we had a little practice. But we were in one of the northern states in America. We had to stay somewhere before we went out on all these lakes. It's an area called Boundary Waters Canoe Area. Amazing. Amazing. And just over the border in Canada, there's an area even bigger called Quetico. Again, you can go on your canoe and you have to get a special license and so on. Anyway, we had to stay somewhere. And when we stayed there for the night, getting ready for our canoe trip, the next morning we got up and we went to have our breakfast. And guess what? The people that were living there, they said to us, that were serving us breakfast, they said, "Did you see that last night?" And I was like, "See what last night?" I was fast asleep. You know, why wouldn't you sleep at night? That's the whole point. And they said, "It was amazing." I was still not clued into what they were talking about. And I said, "What was amazing?" And they said, "We have been here for so many years and we have never seen the Northern Lights like it was last night." And I realized I missed it. And I was thinking in my head, why didn't you come and wake me up? People pay a lot of money to see this kind of thing. And I missed it. I slept through an amazing light display that happened in the sky that night. Now, we can be lights for Jesus. We can have an amazing display in our life, in the way that we live our lives and the things that we do. And I wonder if someone can come and help me read a Bible verse. One of you bigger ones can come and help me read a Bible verse. Come on then. So, can you read that for us? This is in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 6.
"For God, who said, 'Let there be light,' in the darkness has made this light shine in our hearts, so we could know the glory of Jesus that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ."
Okay. So, with my little story, with my illustration, what I missed was an amazing display of lights and colours and so on. But I want to encourage you today for this coming week, as we have all sorts of activities at school or at home and so on, I want to encourage you to display the best light that you can, to display Jesus in all that you do. Would you promise to do that? Would you be willing to do that? To be the best lights you can be? Would someone say a little prayer for us to that end? Come on then, come and say the prayer.
Dear God, thank you for making people, and thank you for making the world. Amen.
Okay, thank you very much. Go and be lovely lights to all that you meet.
Well, I almost don't need to follow the simple prayer of a child, do I? But anyway, I'd just like it if you could just come and join me as we approach our Father in prayer. Our dear and most loving Heavenly Father, Lord, hallowed be your name this morning. What a privilege, Lord, it is to be able to come and worship with you today. Lord, as a group and a community, we thank you so much for fellowship. We thank you, Lord, that you refresh our hearts with this. And Lord, may your Holy Spirit please guide our hearts today in a closer relationship with you, Lord, as we hear your word and delve into it with each other. Lord, I'd like to just raise up people and just say thank you, Lord, for the efforts that we see every week in the way that we want to serve your church, Lord, and to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. And today, Lord, I pray especially for the cafe that will be running at the church tomorrow. This is a new outreach program, Lord, that we want to just uplift. We pray, dear Lord, that you be with each person there who will be serving. We pray that your angels guide the right people there so that, Lord, they will hear and be able to fellowship with people who are spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for just being able to give us the ability to do this and the facilities, Lord, that enable this. Today, Lord, we also ask for the forgiveness of sins. We're so grateful, Lord, that you forgive us. And Lord, may you touch our hearts that we be prepared to forgive all those people around us, no matter what happens, that they see the loving nature of Christ coming through us. Lord, we pray especially this week for those of us who are struggling. We think of financial struggles. We think, dear Lord, of health struggles. And Lord, we just uplift Melita and her family this week to you as well, Lord, that you be with her throughout what will happen this week. Lord, we also present our offerings to you this morning. We thank you, Lord, that we have the ability to come and return these. And Lord, whoever is charged with using them, may they be given the wisdom to be able to do this in the way that is fit and pleasing for you, Lord, that it will advance your word and that hearts will be touched through it. We thank you so much, dear Lord, for your continued love for us. We thank you, Lord, that we are able to display this around us and each of us this week as we interact with each other and with more people around us. May the light of your love be displayed through us. We thank you so much for this, dear Father, this morning, and just pray that you be with us. In your most precious and holy name, Father. Amen.
Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt his worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks her new and glorious morn.
Oh, night divine.
the worship. The worship team have come up with a sequence. A couple of weeks ago, I spoke to you about peace, and this week it's about love. And it is an interactive, get involved kind of week this week. So it won't just be me talking, but I want to introduce this kind of theme and exploration of love and God's love. First, by reading you an article that I came across. It was just published a matter of days ago. But it reads like this: a school choir was forced to withdraw from a Christmas event because organizers branded its carols too religious. Yes, around 60 children aged between 7 and 11 had spent 6 weeks practicing favorites, including Once in Royal David's City and Silent Night for the Corringham Winter Festival, but they were let down at the last minute when their head teacher was informed their program did not dovetail with the festival's theme. One of the parents is quoted as saying, "It's ridiculous that you can't sing religious songs. It's Christmas. When can you sing them?" And on goes the article. The non-religious event was planned by a Corringham Town Festival partnership. Even though the area is in Thurrock, where 75% of the population described themselves in a previous census as Christian. And in that same census, 1% registered themselves as Muslim, and someone, a spokesperson from the Thurrock Islamic Education and Cultural Association, said, "I don't think any Muslims would be offended by carols." It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. They go on to quote, last year, the Bishop of St. David's in Pembrokeshire, the Right Reverend Carl Cooper, warned political correctness was destroying the meaning of Christmas. Have you noticed anything else like that? I guess one of my little bugbears, and if anyone were to visit our home, you would actually find one of my bugbears that I get the opportunity of wiping my feet on when I enter my home. But it says, season's greetings. Anyone come across that phrase? Yeah, on Christmas cards we get more, not happy Christmas, season's greetings. I don't know what it means, really. Season's greeting. Is that supposed to be a proper substitute for Happy Christmas and so on? I'm so sort of gnarled by it. And you know, any time of the year we have a season, don't we? So I'm daring myself for the next year. My greeting to you at any point in the year will be season's greetings. And you'll look at me and think, what on earth are you talking about? Season's greetings. Well, I want to pick up on what this one of the parents says. It's ridiculous. So because this is an interactive thing, I want to invite you to turn someone to someone near you, whether you know them or not. That's up to you, who you turn to, one or two or four people, whatever group you want to turn to. But ask this question, or at least answer this question in your group. Is the lack of religious songs at seasonal events ridiculous? Now you're thinking, what could be my answer? So I'm going to read that out to you again as you turn to people near you. Is the lack of religious songs at seasonal events ridiculous? You've got a few seconds. I'll give you a few moments more in case someone else wants to speak. Okay, hopefully you've exchanged your views and opinions. Is the lack of religious songs at seasonal events ridiculous? Dare I ask anyone to shout out? What did you think?
Negative.
Negative. Well, there we go. We are encouraged, maybe even obliged, to recognise or allow other faith group activities. But then there are some that feel as though we better dumb down Christianity because we don't want to offend anyone. Anyone else, coming back to this question, is the lack of religious songs at seasonal events ridiculous? Any other response? Some.
So it depends what event it is. If I went to an event where I'm celebrating life, and it's expected to hear songs to do with their religious beliefs. Likewise, if I went to it's an event and it's a Christian event, I'd expect to hear Christian songs, religious songs. So it depends which event.
So the answer started with the word depends. And of course, then we open everything right up. But you're right, it depends. When you go somewhere and you're expecting a certain thing, you don't expect something else. And maybe some of what they were expecting in the winter festival was not necessarily a Christmas festival. Behind you. Can you speak right up? Because my hearing is bad. My battery has just run out on my hearing aid, and I'm really struggling.
Can you get my voice a bit more?
Like you're a preacher.
I was just gonna say that even if people are like you know the less evil songs being sung, at the end of the day we're still worshiping it. At the end of the day, whether or not other people. Does it really change how we perceive it? We're still doing what we have to do. So the style of our people were like, less evil songs. That's just another effect of Christmas becoming a lot more commercialized. But if you see it for what it truly is, I think at the end of the day, that's what should matter.
Okay, thank you for running around with the mic. We got the end of the sentence there, but... So, can you say that in one line?
All right. It doesn't matter what other people worship, as long as we're doing what we believe to be right. At the end of the day, I think that's what we should be focusing on. And Christmas has just become commercialized as if we've forgotten the original meaning of Christmas. Christmas was a pagan festival that we kind of just take. But as long as we're like putting the time inside to worship Christmas and what it stands for us, then I think that's a lot more respectable than just it being to waste money.
Okay, we could get involved in lots of other sidetrack conversations out of this as well, but just coming back to my question then, is the lack of religious songs at seasonal events ridiculous? Well, if the seasonal event is non-religious, then it's not ridiculous. But if it's what we are expecting or hoping for, because in this season we have religious songs, then maybe it might seem ridiculous. I'm just digging over this question because I'm just wondering. Can we have one thing without another? Let's go to our scripture reading. 1 John chapter 4. I don't know if you can grab a Bible or turn your Bibles on. And 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 12, we had read to us. Thank you, Charles. Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. As it goes on, anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God, but anyone who does not love does not know God. Let me stop there. Anyone who does not love does not know God. Let's reverse that a bit. Is it possible then for someone to say that they know God, but they do not display love? Is it possible? Where's Nathan going with this one? There's nods, there's shakes, and so on. It's possible for someone to say that they know God, but not display love. But what is this text suggesting then? What is John, the disciple that Jesus loved? What is John saying about those that say that they are followers of God and their display of love? Oh, my hearing aid's gone now. Okay. Do you live
who you say you know?
Do you live who you say you know? That's interesting. Do you live who you say you know? Anyone who does not love does not know God. Therefore, does anyone who says they love God but doesn't display love actually know God? Let's finish that sentence. For God is love. This is one of a few God is references in Scripture. Don't know if any of you remember those old cartoons, Love Is, ... and there'd be the kind of caricatures of a male and a female, and there'd be some sort of little expression underneath. Love is whatever, holding an umbrella for her in the rain, or whatever it was. God is, in this case, it says God is love. There are some other references of God is in John chapter 4, verse 24. God is spirit. This is, we think of things maybe in the physical realm, but God exists in the spiritual realm. God is spirit, and there's a whole lot more to it than that as well. In 1 John, sticking with our particular letter here, 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5, God is light. And what does light do? It illuminates things. Yeah, maybe we feel a little bit uncomfortable with that idea of God being light when God illuminates the things that we feel uncomfortable about in our lives. But God is light. And in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 29, it says God is a, this is even more uncomfortable, that God is a consuming fire. Something that purifies as well as necessarily destroying. But all of these God is references are not, well, God is this at this time, and God is this at this time, and God is this at this time. God is this and this and this and this. All the time. So when God is illuminating something, when God is consuming fire, God is what at the same time? What's our verse? God is love. God is doing it out of love. God wants to keep us in, not catch us out. So for another few minutes. I want you to turn to the people that you turned to, or if they gave really bad answers earlier, turn to someone else. And just read through a couple of those other following verses, because with this idea of God is love, I'm going to impose a definition for you. That this love that God is a love that is seeking another's positive good at one's own expense. That's what this agape love is all about. Love is the seeking of another's positive good at one's own expense. So if God is love, seeking our good at his expense, how is this evidenced in those following few verses? So you can pick it up from 1 John chapter 4, verses, I think, 8 through to 12. I'll give you a couple more minutes just looking. There's two evidences that I'm looking for from you. I'm trying to narrow it down so you're not digging in the wrong places. Two evidences of God's love. So turn to someone near you. You might want to grab your Bibles, turn them on. Don't know if we can whack it up on screen or not, but look at your Bibles, turn to someone near you. Evidences that God is love. How do we know about God's love? Don't forget to let someone else speak as well. So I'll give you a short while more. Thank you. Okay, so we've got a runner with a mic there. If I can draw your attention, you might have got sidetracked, you might have got lost, you might not have got either of these evidences. Maybe you've talked around it, but you've just not realized it. So let's see if we can find if your brains are in tune with mine as well. So we're looking for these evidences of the God is love. So anyone want to speak up as to what they found in their group?
He gave his life for us as a sacrifice, and number two, that we might have life through his name.
Okay, you're right on both counts there. Thank you very much, George. But one of those definitely I want to pick up on. So I'll come back to Lydia's at the back with her hand up, or was, unless that was the same one. So let me just dig over that one quickly. It says there in 1 John chapter 4, this is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. God is love. And how do we see that evidence of love? Before we even loved God, God loved us. And he said, ready to say, I'm ready to do this for them. This is how much I love them. I want to keep them in, not catch them out. This is the evidence of God's love. He can't help but do this. So he gave his one and only Son just on that point. There are a couple of other references in Scripture talking about Abraham and his one and only Son. And also in with the widow of Nain, she was referenced as having a one and only son. There's a point of emphasis. Is it some of what God had, or all of what God had? His one and only son. There's a point of emphasis. I'm not giving a bit, one of my sons. I'm giving you my one and only. So, God is love. It's evidenced by his giving of his son. That we might have what?
Life.
We might have life. Life, therefore, if we reverse that thinking, life can only come through what Jesus has done for us. Have we got the mic at the back? Is this another one? Are you going to have a guess? Or
I wanted to say almost the same thing as George said, but then in verse 12, it says that no one has ever seen God. But if we love each other, God lives in us, and his love is brought to full expression in us. That's a New Living Translation, which I think so many times, I personally have failed that. I wasn't able to love everyone as God has commanded us. So I think that's something that we have to aim to, and obviously we can do that just through God.
You're a great bunch. You've hit the nails on the head both first times. So God is love. God loved us. And this is how he sorted it out and displayed that love. That's the evidence. His one and only son. That we might have life eternal, or however the expression we want to use and dig out. And God loves us through our actions for him. That's really what you're saying, picking up on. That's certainly what I'm imposing onto that text. God is love. God shows us his love through what he did in sending his one and only son, and what that achieved, and what he does through us. So as you go into the rest of your week, I need to think about this idea of love. God's love. God's love isn't just something that we receive. It's something that we can enjoy continually. God's love is something that we can experience as we love others the way that God loves them too. May God bless you in this season of love.
Let's all stand for the closing song. It is called Ode, the Deep, Deep Love of Jesus, and it's to the tune of Morning Has Broken. Follow Charles.
Underneath me,
all the men voices.
All around me is a current of thy love, leading onward, leading onward to thy glorious rest above.
And all the ladies, let's follow Kaya.
To glory for
it's a busy, kind of hectic time of the year, all different kinds of reasons. Lord, as we heard from that story, some people thinking it's ridiculous not to be able to sing of you. Lord, whoever we meet, however ridiculous they feel about the good news of Jesus, about the love of God, may we be ready to speak up and speak out, to show and share your love with other people, even if it costs us something. Lord, we thank you for your example. As we know that God is love, God, may we be conduits of your love to each other. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, how he loves you and me. Just sing it one more time.
Oh, how he loves you.